Hi, welcome back to The Shtick. We're in the studio with Steven Shamrak.
Hello.
Nice to have you back.
Thank you.
Yeah, we went a bit off the beaten track in the last segment. I wanted to talk to you about politics because it's so important for me and for the world to try and resolve what's going on. But there's always some sort of resistance, you know, no matter where we go. Yeah. And you've been writing political arguments and analysis. What is the way we can go forward? What do you think is the way we can go forward in the whole situation, particularly in the Middle East?
Okay. In order to resolve something, you need to know that you have a problem and you need to will or desire to achieve solution.
Mm.
Basically, neither side, nor Arabs, even Israel and United Nations definitely, or other players, have this will.
They don't have the will?
No, they're actually interested in maintaining status quo in order to kind of control, manipulate. I know it sounds a bit of like a conspiracy theories. It's easier to push their agenda and political issues when there is instability in the region.
Mm. Well, we've had a bit of instability in Australia last year when we had the change of prime ministers, and then we've had this kind of neo-fascist, white supremacist event that happened this week. And again, we're having problems resolving it. Everybody's in conflict.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't actually saw this news, but I read about it. And in my opinion, we live in lucky country. We live in democracy, Australia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I totally against neo-Nazi, and I'm totally against communism. But because we are in a free speech environment, they had a right to express their opinion. The same thing like a communist have the right to express their opinion. But people have the right to listen and understand ugliness of both sides.
Mm.
What we saw in this particular case, we saw neo-Nazi came to protest whatever they wanted to protest.
Well, it was particularly about the gangs, the African, what we call as African gangs.
And this is a problem too.
Which became, it is a problem, but I particularly think that they're just looking at one particular problem. We have many different violent situations that happen. People break into cars, break into houses, beat people up, you know, break into shops. It's not just the Africans that do it. When you look at the statistics.
Okay.
So why did Fraser Anning and all his, Dutton and all those people pick on one particular group?
Okay, I explain to you. They have their political agenda. So they choose particular group who more or less visible in order to push their political agenda.
Mm.
A communist or Antifa has their political agenda to bring attention to themselves. Therefore, instead of keeping rally next day against Nazis, they choose to come at the same day. So basically speaking, it's yin and yang. Both of them playing the same game in order to promote themselves.
Because that's what happens. They want to get the media focus, the media spotlight on their ugly agenda. You know, they have an agenda and they want to do that. But everybody wants to get on with their lives. But at the same time, we need to consider safety of the community. We have a safety issue.
That's why there was a heavy presence of police there, just to avoid the ugliness between those two groups.
But there was still a lot of ugliness. When you look at the media and the photos and the images that we got, was the Nazi salutes and the SS helmets, which is the media seems to emphasize.
And media does it all the time. Like, for example, I saw some reports showing the media, big, huge demonstration somewhere, blah, blah, blah. But they show the real footage. There were a dozen or two people standing there protesting, empty streets around, but media made a selective close-up copy, and this event looked like a major political event.
Mm.
The same thing here. Why Antifa or those anarchists, whatever, came in the same day? They could come to another day and protest and so on. So instead of hearing, average Australian, instead of hearing what the political message is, they only saw the ugly fight.
And on the front page of The Australian this week, a fellow called Dr. Dvir Abramovich, who is the head of the Anti-Defamation Commission, talked about the anti-Semitism involved mm-hmm. in that's been rising in relation to this particular group.
Yeah.
And the Jewish community is getting it from the fascists and from the
left,
Antifa,
yeah.
The left and the right. Both attacking the Jews, not directly, but there is...
Henry, it's not a new. For example, in Soviet Union, anti-Semitism was state-sponsored. Mm. In Nazi Germany, anti-Semitism, ugly, was state-sponsored. In all kingdoms, in European and otherwise, they use anti-Semitism in order to detract attention from local problem, from kings, whatever, and redirected their anger on Jews.
Yeah, we've always been the scapegoat, right? And this is the point I was trying to make about the African gangs. The African gangs are seen now as the scapegoat. The anti-Semitism is kept in check at the moment because the government on both sides is pro-Israel. Or not so much the left anymore, but there's still, you know, we're living in a country where there is political correctness about Israel, especially when Fraser Anning,
okay.
the senator, said, "Oh, I'm nothing against Jews. I'm a friend of Israel." You know,
like again, he brought attention by saying the final solution in order to self-promote, because by saying this, in my opinion. He attract criticism because before that nobody knew who he is.
Again, there's attention seeking.
Self-promotion, attention seeking. So, but in order to African gains, nothing new. For example, in America, in the 2030s, there were Irish gains, there were Italian gains, and so on, so on. Every minority which organized in criminal activity, mafia or otherwise, like, for example, we had in Elsterwick a chain of robberies by African-Americans of the jewelry store. Mm-hmm. It's not without actually generalizing. It simply became visible. And honestly speaking, media, it's an hysterical attempt to raise the readership, creating a lot of problem as well.
That's it. We'll be back with you after the break. We'll have Steven Shamrak coming back. We'll have a bit of music in the next segment. And also we'll be talking about your actual profession, which is what you do as a psychology practitioner. Alternative.
I call it alternative practitioner, or sometimes I call it stress reduction training.
What sort of training?
Stress reduction training.
Stress reduction. Well, I'm getting really stressed out here. Because I'm really not used to being back on the shtick. But welcome back, and we'll be back after the break.